No, Abby Kuhn does have a lot to teach us about social media. So I've been told I'm like the token social media person here. It's the token social media talk. So that's me. We are going to talk about the internet is for porn, social media lessons learned from Abby Kuhn the musical. And if you haven't seen it, I really hope that after listening to this, you'll really want to, because it's so much more than just Muppets having sex. Are all based on my favorite songs from Avenue Q, the musical. The first one is that internet is for porn. It's about giving people what they want. If your site is boring, if it doesn't engage them, if it doesn't appeal to some, I don't want to say base or instinct, but some real driving need, if it doesn't fuel their passion, then your site's going to be really boring. And that's why your Facebook page doesn't get any visits, right? And I don't know how many social media people have said, how do I get visitors on my Facebook page? How do I get interaction on the Facebook page? Well, I'm not saying put porn up there. By any means, the way you do that is through finding out what your followers are passionate about. Let's assume it's not porn, but there's something that's going to appeal to them. And the social media lesson here is you find, I mean, porn does a lot of things really well. Porn, the producers, they know their audience, they know it appeals to them, and they give them exactly what it is that they want, right? And that's exactly what we should do in social media as well. Okay, so lesson number two, one of my favorite songs from Avenue Q, everything is only for now. Everything is temporary, everything is fleeting. Your hits, your traffic, your campaign, it's just for now. Engagement happens on a daily basis. It's what you do every day, not what you did last week. You can't do a campaign last week and expect that exact same thing will work again, right? You have to constantly be innovating and constantly engaging. So whatever you do right now is great, and if it's fantastic, great. Just keep in mind that Old Spice is only for now. That was a great campaign. What are you going to do next? Dell Hell, also only for now. It came and went. The idea, I guess what I want to hit home here is we learn from each one of these campaigns. We don't want to be iterative. We don't want to repeat exactly what it is that somebody else did. Has anybody seen some of those, like, Old Spice campaign knockoffs? They really suck, don't they? Right. Because that was in the moment. It worked for them. It was for now. It's over. And now we've got to try something new. Try something different. Find out what your fans and your followers want and engage them. So the next song would... lesson learned from Avenue Q, the musical, is everyone is a little bit racist.
So the Bible boys learn to speak goddamn English.
Right.
Everyone's a little bit racist today. So everyone's a little bit racist. Okay. Ethnic jokes might be uncouth, but to laugh because they're based on truth.
So what I took away from this song is that when you're managing a community online, you're going to come across a huge variety of expectations and perceptions. You can't go in assuming everybody wants the same thing as you, and you can't assume that you really know your audience really, really well. There's going to be a variety of opinions. There's going to be a variety of viewpoints. Not everyone is starting from the same place. So to me, whenever I managed a community, the goal was to start with the passion. Find out what they're really passionate about. And you know what? Let them duke it out in the community. As long as you moderate and facilitate, that's what the community is for. The next song from Avenue Q that I took a lesson from is, if you were gay, that'd be okay. to me, this is about knowing your target audience and being inclusive. Again, don't assume that everyone is straight.
Why are you staring at me?
Because you were pointing a freaking camera at me. That's why. be inclusive. Do your research. Find out what's going to incite their passions, and then figure out how to stimulate that. Next lesson is, you can be as loud as the hell you want when you're making love. Another one of my favorite songs. Here's my favorite snippet.
Tell them to quiet down.
Are we being too loud?
Are we bothering someone?
Oh, no, not at all, kids.
You keep doing what you're doing.
You're not allowed to be loud.
Oh, my God, are you killing me? My record dancing.
Doing the hashtag, don't make
away from this is when we go out and meet people in real life, and we should go out and meet people in real life, social media shouldn't just be contained on your Facebook page and on Twitter. The best stuff actually happens with real people in real space, in real time, actually meeting in a place where you can physically go out and touch someone.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God, it's a real person.
I've got girl parts.
You know, the listening took away. Did you just say I've got girl parts? In terms of social media, yeah, you can do all the stuff in Twitter and you can get like 3,000 followers or 10,000 followers, and that's great. Big deal. Who cares? So what? What are you doing with them? How are you engaging with them? The same thing with Facebook. Like, you can get a zillion followers on your page, but if they're not actually interacting, you know, who the frack cares, really? And I said frack.
I know, BSG.
I know. I'm geek. Okay, so it's encouragement. I took this as we need to go out and get in real space, real people in real time, and let them make real connections. But the other thing I took away from comparing, you can be as loud as the hell you want when you're making love, to social media and social media outreach and campaigns, is that human interactions are messy. They are. I mean, you go out in real life and, you know, sometimes people get drunk, sometimes they say the wrong thing, you know, sometimes there's social awkwardness. You've been hearing me rail on the Seattle breeze. Sometimes it's not really comfortable. And that's all part of the social part of social media. I don't think we should shy away from that just because in real life, well, we don't know how people are actually going to react. I think the real power of social media is getting real people together in real time and connecting face-to-face for real. And finally, my last observation, which is going to be a really short session, is Schadenfreude. Does anybody who hasn't seen this, do you just know what that means? So, Schadenfreude is taking happiness at the misery of others. And at first I wasn't going to include this, but Carlos, who did the last session, said that's everything online. Schadenfreude is why sites like the Fail Blog is so successful, because we just love to watch other people fail. And I was thinking in terms of PR, and I thought the Bad Pitch Blog, because boy, do we love to see how other people really, really suck at PR. That's awesome. It just makes us feel better that, you know what, I may not be that great, but at least I'm not that bad, right? And I was even thinking about things like, you know, the oatmeal with the sites like, he does the man movies and the women with mustaches. We just like to see other people that are, you know, less attractive and more humiliated than us, so that our daily humiliation doesn't seem quite so bad. So I just want to play my favorite part of that song.
People take deep pleasure in your pain.
Oh, Schadenfreude, huh? Wow, what's that, some kind of Nazi word?
Yup, it's German for happiness, the misfortune of others.
Happiness is the misfortune of others. That is German.
Watching a vegetarian, he told she just ate chicken.
Or watching a frat boy realize just what he put his dick in.
Not rated G. So, those are the lessons that I took from Avenue Q for social media. I throw it to you. And I think that's really, you know, in terms of community, if you want people coming back on a daily basis, you kind of have to do what they do with porn. Is you find out exactly what they want, you find out where they're pausing and rewinding, and give them that. And then ask, sorry, is that too crass? And then give them more, right?
Ooh, not crass enough.
Okay. Just because viral tools are available to us does not mean that your lame-ass PR stunt is going to go viral. Right? I mean,
yeah, true.
Who's ever been asked to create a viral video? Can I just see a show of hands? Asked, not did it, right. Okay, see, you can't create a viral video, right? You can create a video that, if it has a porn-like attraction for your particular following, which you have diagnosed with metrics and you know what they want and you lurked and found out exactly what's going to appeal to them, there is a possibility that it will go viral because of the tools we have available. But
I thought it was just dumb luck.
I think there is some dumb luck involved. I would say there is some dumb luck involved, but it's also, you know, if you create something that will appeal to your users and appeal to your community in a porn-like way, if you hit that funny bone, that sense of humor, I don't want to say two girls, one cup, because that was just... if you're Dave Carroll making United Breaks guitars, see, nice, clean example. I mean, that's something that everyone can relate to. He just made the video because he did the song because he was frustrated, right? That video got huge because everyone that saw it has felt that level of frustration with corporate customer service, right? Everyone can relate to that. That's common, universal. Steven Slater, I have a blog post brewing on that one about whether Steven Slater, do you guys know him? He's the JetBlue flight attendant that there was a passenger that hit him with some luggage and the passenger wasn't supposed to be up and refused to apologize. And so Steven apparently got on the PA and let out a string of obscenities, reportedly grabbed 80 or 2, depending upon which report you read, and then took the slide, made the great dramatic exit, took the slide out of the plane and just went home. Right? And there's a question as to whether is he a folk hero or is he just, a really, really bad customer service rep. I think it's a little bit of both because,
And then there's also the girl that quit by whiteboarding.
I have not seen that one.
Yeah, but that's still viral in a big way. It was a hoax, but it was still, the guys who created actually said that they wanted to see if they could create something viral, and it did. So.
Yeah. Well, there is something genuinely pornographic about that. Because Jared's pool tweeted today, I don't understand why people are excited about this whole Steven Slater thing. I'm like, you need to go watch Network. The whole, I'm as bad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
Right.
It's the idea that there's somebody out there that would do something that you would never do in a million lifetimes, but you get to live through them for that one moment.
It's the personification of a revenge fantasy. I mean, to me, that's, who hasn't fantasized about doing something crazy at work when you won the lottery, or yelling at that customer who is just a freaking idiot? We all fantasize about it. Most of us don't do it because we have self-preservation instincts. That's why I think Steven Slater has become a folk hero, because he did, even though I don't think any of us would want to be in the position that he's in where, he lost his job, he's now got this bad reputation. There's a part of us that really does like what he did, because anyone who's ever been in the customer service industry has wanted to just yell obscenities at that obnoxious customer with a huge sense of entitlement. I mean, who hasn't wanted to do that? And that's that's actually getting to the point of it, right? That's that thing that we all have in common, that we all get, that we wanted to do, but we're not going to do it, but we are going to watch it, right? We are going to watch in fascination. To me, that's what makes a video viral. That's what makes a community exciting. That's what makes you pass on saying, oh my God, guys, you got to look at this.
I was just thinking. So, does anyone know whose law it is? It's like if you can think of it, there's porn of it on
Rule 34.
Rule 34.
It's Rule 34. Thank you. Rule 34. There's going to be porn about this on the internet.
If you can conceive of it, there's porn of it.
Yes, if you can conceive of it, there's porn of it on the internet. So I wonder if there isn't a Rule 34 for social media, right? If you can conceive of it, out there somewhere is some niche group that actually has self-formed, and they may not have 50,000 followers, but they've got 50 passionate followers.
I love that idea. So if you can conceive of it, there is some group out there that you will be a hero to.
There is an audience for there. It's hard if you're trying to get a million, because when you've got 10 people, well, they can be three standard deviations away from the norm, right? They can be way off in left field. But once you get a million people, everyone, on average, they're pretty average.
Yeah.
So you're looking at a pretty average niche. So what they're going to like, it's going to be pretty average. And so if you're looking for real passion, look at those weird little niches, because they're the people who are going to be,
Find the freaks.
Find the freaks.
I like that. That's a good message.
Look in the corners to find the freaks.